Once again today, we greet you in the lovely name of our dear Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We welcome you here in the auditorium in the Northside Baptist Church. We welcome our visitors. And you that's listening out in the radio listening audience, we appreciate you tuning in to the Northside Baptist Church Hour. It's coming to you live right from the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church here in Athens. And this is Preacher Edward speaking. We hope in doing the hour coming up, we can be an inspiration to you. And we, you that know God, we covet your prayers as we continue in the service. Take your Bible today and turn, would you please, to Daniel chapter 5. It's page 906 in the original Scofield Reference Bible. I'm speaking today on the subject, All Shook Up. The tape number today is 367. If you'd like to have this tape with the singing, the music, and the message, if you write in and send a gift of $3 or more and request the tape, I'll get it in the mail to you. You can request it by the title of it, All Shook Up, or you can request it by the number 367. In my book on number 2 of Bible Questions and Answers Everyone Should Know, on page 4, you'll find the answers to these questions. Who is the oldest man that ever lived, yet he died before his father did? Where is the first place in the Bible that man was put to sleep for surgery? What men in the Bible killed 1/4 of the world's population at one time? Who was the first woman died giving birth to a child? Does God speak in dreams? Where do you find a cheerleader in the Bible? What men in the Bible did God tell to make some perfume? What men in the Bible had a father but no mother? Who was known as a reckless driver in the Bible? What man got a haircut and resulted in the loss of his life? What man did not get a haircut and resulted in the loss of his life? Who was the wicked queen that literally went to the dogs? Who was the famous wild game hunter in the Bible? And who was the first drunk named in the Bible? You find the answer to these Bible questions on page 4 of book number 2. You can get this book by writing in and send a gift of $2 or more. I have 5 of these books. You can have all 5 for a gift of $10. I want you to pray for me and write to me. I want to hear from you. And if you appreciate this ministry, you appreciate the broadcast each Sunday morning, then I'd like to hear from you. My mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia, 30603 is the zip code number. This is a faith ministry. That means that you can help take care of the radio expense. Let me hear from you. If you'd like to have a list of our cassette tape, we send you a list of 365 we have listed, and you can write in and get a list of these tape, and you can select the ones you'd like to have if you'd like to have some of these. Man called me this morning and heard the message on the Antichrist. Now we have that of tape, of course. I brought that message a couple of weeks ago on the Antichrist, and he wanted to know if the Antichrist was alive in the world today. Well, I told you what I believed about it in that message, and these tapes can be a real inspiration to you. Now with your Bible open at Daniel chapter 5, page 906 in the Scofield Bible, we begin reading with verse 1. Belshazzar the king made a great feast to 1,000 of his lords and drank wine before the 1,000. Belshazzar, while he tasted the wine, commanded to bring the gold and silver vessels which his father Nebuchadnezzar had taken out of the temple which was in Jerusalem, that the king and his princes, his wives, his concubines might drink therein. Then they brought the golden vessels that were taken out of the temple of the house of God, which was at Jerusalem, and the king and his princes, his wives, and his concubines drank in them. They drank wine and praised the gods of gold, of silver, of brass, of iron, of wood, and of stone. In the same hour came forth fingers of a man's hand and wrote over against a candlestick upon the plaster of the wall of the king's palace, and the king saw the part of the hand that wrote. Then the king's countenance was changed, and his thoughts troubled him, So the joints of his loins were loosed, and his knees smote one against another. The king cried aloud to bring in the astrologers, the Chaldeans, and the soothsayers. And the king spake and said to the wise men of Babylon, whosoever shall read this writing and show me the interpretation thereof shall be clothed with scarlet, have a chain of gold about his neck, and shall be the third ruler in the kingdom. In verse 6, the Bible tells you that this man was all shook up. And that's the title of my subject today. That's what I'm speaking on, rather, my message. And I want you to listen to the Word of God. We're going to give you some historical facts as well as the scripture today pertaining to what happened here in Babylon. Now, Nebuchadnezzar was a great monarch. He's a great ruler. He ruled all the known world at that time. He had great power, no man in the world as Nebuchadnezzar in those days. He's the first great Gentile ruler and controlled practically the whole world. He married a woman that was somewhat dissatisfied there in the desert. It's because she had lived in the mountains. In order to please her, according to history, he built the great hanging gardens there in Babylon. Babylon was the great wonder of the world in those days, and Babylon was built on the river of Euphrates. Half of Babylon was on one side of the river, the other half on the other side, the river running down through the middle of the little city of Babylon. They had a huge wall around Babylon. The wall was 15 miles in each direction, 60 miles around the entire wall. Right down through the middle of that city ran the beautiful river Euphrates. Now they decided they wanted to tile that river, and so they dug a channel around the river, around the wall on the outside, and there they forced the river to go around on the outside until they could tile the beautiful river on the inside. And so they tiled that river. It was 30 feet deep and 60 feet wide, and they tiled it, and they had beautiful birds on the tiles of that river, very beautiful. Of course, when they completed tiling the river, then they turned the river back under the wall on the upper side, and she began to flow down through the city. And for 15 miles, that river flowed down through the city, 60 feet wide, 30 feet deep, and 15 miles long down through the middle of that great city. It looked like a beautiful swimming pool all the way from one wall to the other, 15 miles long. Now it had a 60-mile wall around it, four square, 60-mile wall. Keep that in mind. And that wall at the bottom was 700 feet thick at the bottom, 300 feet at the top, and six chariots with six horses could each run abreast on the top. It had an outside wall 200 feet high, separated by 50 feet of water, and soldiers stayed on this wall and crossed over by a jackknife bridge. And every 14 feet, they had a pot of hot oil to throw on the heads of the enemy if they tried to come in and conquer Babylon. Now they were sure no one could ever conquer Babylon. But there were some leaders. Two kings got together. We find that Cyrus and the Median, Kedarus and Cyrus got together. And the Persian, of course, and the other king there connived together and planned together how they might come in and conquer Babylon. And so they came in and began to search out the situation and tried to conquer Babylon. They couldn't get over the wall, and there's no way they could conquer that city, but they had a plan. And they began to plan something about how they might conquer Babylon. Nebuchadnezzar now had died and gone on, and Belshazzar, his grandson, had taken over. And he was in charge of Babylon at that time. And so the Medes and the Persians said, we can somehow or another conquer Babylon. Now when God Almighty gets ready for a city to fall, that city will fall. Just like Jericho in the days of Joshua. When God gets ready for a nation to fall, that nation will fall. Nothing man can do about it. Many great nations have fallen in the past. Many great nations have been strong, like Rome and Greece and various other nations, but they have gone down. Where are they today? Beloved, one of these days, I'm sorry to have to tell you this, but one of these days, if America keeps on in her sins and sin abounding like it is today, America will go down if Jesus tarries his coming, no doubt about it. I know that some of you will say, well, Preacher Edwards, we're too strong. Nobody can conquer America. We're the strongest nation in the world. We're the richest nation in the world. And we have much wisdom. And we're well planned and well fortified, and we'll always be strong. Don't kid yourself. There's a God in heaven. And when God gets enough of this terrible sin in America, God knows how to lower the boom on this country and bring it to her knees. And that's going to happen if Jesus tarries his coming. You mark my word. Because sin is abounding every day. People are more and more evil every day. I was listening today on the radio getting the news, and some three or four young teenagers died in separate car wrecks last night. No doubt drunken driving, on dope, on whiskey, out drunk driving too fast. And our teenagers are killing themselves every day in automobiles and on dope and whiskey. Not only the teenagers, but adults as well. And so this huge wall was built around this city. Many people dwell therein. The river Euphrates, 60 feet wide, 30 feet deep, 15 miles long, ran down the middle of it. And of course it was tile, with beautiful tile, and the beautiful designs of birds on the tile. They are very beautiful there on the inside of Babylon. And then when Cyrus came in, and the Medes and the Persians rather came in Darius, there they planned a way whereby that they could conquer Babylon. They noticed on the outside of Babylon, the great 700-foot wall, at the bottom there was an old tunnel of a riverbed around on the outside. They noticed that. Not only that, but on the outside of that big wall, 700 feet thick at the bottom. That means it's seven times as long as this church, because this church auditorium from the front door to the baptistry is 100 feet. And it was 700 feet thick at the bottom, 300 feet thick at the top, the wall did. And it began, of course, to narrow down from the bottom up to the top. And so it was 300 feet thick at the top. That's three times as wide as this church is long. So they had this huge wall around it. On the outside of this huge wall, they had water out there, about 50 feet of water, and then they had another wall 200 feet high on the outside of the large wall. They had this 50 feet of water, this moat of water around the city of Babylon. And then they had jackknife bridges that they could cross over from the huge wall to the smaller wall. And there were always soldiers that stood guard on the 200 feet wall on the outside. They had those jackknife bridges. If need be, they could go back across the moat and then trip those bridges, raise them up, and nobody could get to the big wall without swimming 50 feet of water. Not only that, but on the small wall, there they had pots of hot lead boiling at all times, and they had soldiers standing by. If anyone tried to scale that wall, they'd pour that hot lead upon their heads as they tried to get over that wall. So you see, it's a real problem for any other nation to come in and conquer Babylon. And Nebuchadnezzar, and then of course Belshazzar, they said, we are secure. There's nobody can conquer our great Babylon. We're the strongest people in the world. We rule the world practically, and nobody can conquer us. We got it made. And so they were living it up on the inside of Babylon, living in sin and worshiping Baal on the inside of that city, living in drunkenness and so forth. And then of course we find the Medes and the Persians, they figured out how they might be able to conquer Babylon. But you must remember, it was in God's plan that they conquer Babylon, because Nebuchadnezzar was that head of gold of Daniel's image. And then, of course, the silver was the Medes and the Persians. They would have come in later after the head of gold had run its course, Nebuchadnezzar and his kingdom. Then the Medes and Persians, there the silver kingdom must take over. And they did. The silver. And so they must take over. And they did in due time. according to the Bible. So when God gets ready for a nation to fall, that nation can fall. Many strong nations like Rome and like Greece and like Germany at one time, such a strong nation. England, such a powerful nation. Well, today they're second-class nations as far as power and authority is concerned. Many of them, some of them third class. So when God gets ready for a nation to go down, there's nothing the people can do about it on the inside of that nation. That's exactly what would happen to America if God decided for this nation to go down. She had to crumble within and fall from within and become so corrupt until God Almighty would see that she went down to her knees. Now, of course, on the inside of that great banquet hall, they had a table, a dining table, 1 mile long and 1/4 mile wide. And they had hanging flowers around that great dining table. And they had 1,000 lamps of gold. And there were tables on the inside of that dining hall in horseshoe shape. And that's where they would come in for their banquet. Now they saw the Medes and Persians out on the outside of that building digging around the outside. But they thought they were trying to dig in under the wall. And so Belshazzar said to his lords and his leaders, he said, you know, those foolish Medes and Persians, they're out there digging around. They think they're going to dig under this wall. And after they dug out the old riverbed around the great wall, then they pulled back into the forest to wait until nighttime. They knew what they were going to do. And Belshazzar said, they've given up. They see they can't dig under the wall, so they've given up. They left us. They're going back home. Goodbye. I'm glad they're gone. They learned they can't dig under this wall. But he didn't know what they'd really done. What they'd really done, they dug out the old riverbed. And they had in mind that night they would come in, cut the river off at the upper side of the wall. They went down through Babylon and turned around the old riverbed and let the river run around on the outside. And so Belshazzar said, now they're left. They cannot conquer us. We'll have a feast. We'll have a party. We'll have a big time. We'll have a dance. We want the music. We want the wine. We want the women. We're going to have a wonderful time tonight in the dining hall because they realize they can't dig in and it's time for a great party. So that night while they were having the great party, the great banquet, that's when the Medes and Persians came and turned the river around the old riverbed. And then whenever the river ran dry, that went under the wall on the upper side and ran around on the outside, that's whenever the soldiers went under that wall. And it went under that wall and down through that riverbed and up into the great city of Babylon. And everybody was drunk. Not only the lords and their concubines and wives were drunk in the banquet hall, but people all over Babylon by the thousands were drinking and drunk and dancing and praising the God of Baal. And they didn't realize, they had no idea that those soldiers would be coming down that riverbed and they're conquering Babylon. So whenever they went in there to capture Babylon, they killed drunk people. Some 250,000 people died in their own blood there that very night whenever those soldiers went in and killed the people. That blood flowing in every direction. Kills drunks and harlots and whoremongers and worshipers of Baal and gamblers and all the evil people that were on a drunk out there parading around and celebrating. They died with the sword of the Medes and Persians. And they went on the inside of that dining hall, inside of the city, and they were having the party in the dining hall. Now the old king Belshazzar said, I want my lords to bring their wives and seat them at the table, and we want the music. They had 1,000 music instruments in the banquet hall. He said, bring in the musical instruments, and we'll have music, we'll have a dance, we'll drink to our full, we'll eat, drink, and be merry. And they started doing that. Now when the lords came in, 1,000 of the lords came in, there they sat down at the horseshoe-shaped table, there to where the table made the round shape, oval shape. The Lord will sit on the outside of that table. His number one concubine or wife would sit directly in front of him. And then his other wives and lords would, or other wives and concubines rather, would sit down on down to the end of the table. And those lords had anywhere from maybe 100 to 200 to 300 wives and concubines seating there at those tables. They were having a ball. And so they would sit there, and the less favorite wives on each end of the table. And they had from 50 to 350 wives and concubines. And they would be served by a special Ethiopian waiter with a golden cart drawn by 25 peacocks, harnessed with gold and silver harness. Now get this in mind, that was the Ethiopian waiter, well-dressed, and he had golden carts pulled by 25 strutting peacocks coming to each table to deliver the food. And they had provisions there on the inside of that wall to last 25 years. They had stacked up provisions just in case they needed them, just in case they had armies to surround them and they couldn't get out to buy their provisions. They had enough to last 25 years. And they all came in and they sat down, the lord at the table at the upper end, at wherever it rounded out, and then, of course, as extended toward the end, then, of course, his wives and concubines sat on the sides down toward the end of the tables. Now, when the lord wished to make a toast to the king, He'd mount a spiral staircase and ride it out. Now it was plastered on the wall, and of course a platform there where the Lord could go up and there write out a toast to King Belshazzar. It was on a white plastic wall. They used a dark chalk to write out the toast, and he would mount the staircase. He'd go up there, the staircase run. He'd go up there and write out a toast to the king. Now, when he wrote out a toast to the king, then the trumpeter would blow his trumpet, trumpet number one. And whenever he blew that trumpet number one, although they might not be able to see that wall all over the dining hall, but they knew whenever that trumpet blasted off that a man had written a toast on the wall up there, and many of them could see that toast. Of course, Belshazzar was sitting nearby, is playing to him, and they'd write out a toast, "Long live Belshazzar," or something of that type. And then, of course, the trumpeter would blow his trumpet. And when he did, the lord and the wives would stand up. And then the second trumpeter would blow his trumpet. And when they did that, they filled their goblets with wine. And then the third trumpeter would blow his trumpet. And when they did that, the lord would drink out of that goblet. He drank as much wine as he wanted. And he'd take the balance of that wine in that container and throw it in the bosom of his wife, his most favorite wife, sitting directly in front of him. And when he'd poured enough wine on her, each time they gave a toast, he'd pour some wine on her. And when he poured enough wine on her to saturate her clothing, she'd immediately begin to undress. And she'd take off all of her clothing and stand nude before her lord. And they did that in the dining hall at all the tables in the dining hall. They were living it up. They were eating and drinking and making merry. They didn't realize that the hand of God was about to be levied against them. They didn't realize that that night they were going to be slain. They didn't realize that God Almighty had taken over and he was going to take care of the situation. Now, when the Lord wished to make a toast to the king, he'd mount a staircase, as I said a moment ago, and write it out. And when he wrote, the bugler would blow a first blast, and then a third, and a second, and a third. And as I said, on the third one is when he poured the wine in the bosom of his special wife, direct in front of him. And they longed and desired, in order to have the wine poured upon them, that they might become nude before their lord standing directly in front of them. They looked forward to that. They longed for that purpose, in order to become nude before their lord. Now the banquet was in real swing, and then of course each one would go up and write out his toast on the plaster of the wall there. Then they did the same thing over and over again. They began to dance. They were in a drunken stupor. They were eating. They were making merry. Wine was flowing. And they were carrying on in such manner until they probably even forgot they was in the world. They were so living it up. And then while they were doing that, that's when the Medes and Persians came in and down the old riverbed, down through the Babylon, came out the gates that led into the riverbed, up through the streets, and killed the people that they came in contact with down there in the city of Babylon. Remember, Babylon was 60 miles around, 15 either direction. And so they killed everyone they would meet. They would kill them. and they lay there bleeding to death and mourning and groaning, of course, in their own blood. And then they went into the banquet hall. And when the Darius walked in the banquet hall, old Belshazzar, he was living it up. He is yelling out to the people, Lord, I eat, drink, and be merry. Have a good time. Enjoy yourself. There's no harm that anything can harm us. But what had really happened, someone had suggested that Belshazzar go and bring the golden and silver vessels that they had captured in Jerusalem. It came out of the temple of God. Remember in the temple of God in Jerusalem, there they had golden and silver vessels designed from heaven, given by dreams, built by silversmiths, and they had ordered to design those golden and silver vessels and place them in the house of God. They were very sacred vessels. They were sacred. They were sanctified. They were holy vessels. And when Nebuchadnezzar went in and captured Jerusalem, there he brought those vessels back to Babylon, and they had them stored away. In his drunken stupor, someone suggested, sir, why don't we get those golden and silver vessels that you brought back from the house in Jerusalem out of the temple and drink our wine out of them? No sooner suggested that Belshazzar said, that's a good idea. Somebody bring them in. And the service brought in those beautiful golden and silver vessels designed by the silversmiths. They're designed from dreams from heaven and by the hand of God. And God told them how to design those vessels. And they brought them in, very sacred, very holy vessels. And they poured their wine in there and began to drink. They were having a ball. And about time they began to drink out of those golden and silver vessels, there appeared a handwriting on that wall. Mene, mene, tekel, upharsin. That was a handwriting up there. And that handwriting said this, thou art weighed in the balances and found wanting. In other words, Belshazzar, you stepped over God's deadline. You're weighed in the balance. You're going to die tonight. You've gone too far in your sins. You've led these people too far astray in your sins. And you're going to die tonight. Many, many tekel upharsin, thou art weighed in the balances and found wanting. And that night, Belshazzar died. We find that Darius went in, walked up behind Belshazzar, threw his arm around his neck, took a dagger, and stuck it clean through his body, and dropped him down in his own blood, and he died there in that dining hall. There we find the Medes and Persians took over Babylon, exactly like God said they would. And there in that particular village or city, there was a huge Tower of Babel erected many feet high, and many huge pillars, and much gold and silver had gone into this idol, image of Baal there in the city of Babylon. And they worshiped the god Baal, the false god. And young women could hang around that image of Baal. And they would sell their virtue for a price of money. And whatever they got for their virtue, then they would give that money to Baal. And that was their lifelong atonement of financial obligation to Baal. And they said as many sometimes as 10,000 young virgins would stand around that image waiting for some man to come by and give them a certain amount of money for their virtue. And then they would take that money and give it to Baal as a long life offering they would give to Baal. And think about as many as 10,000 at a time would stand around there and wait for that particular time when some man would come by and offer them a certain amount of money. And that's the kind of thing was going on in Babylon. Worshiping Baal, living in drunkenness and idolatry, living in a life like they were living there in adultery and fornication. There God looked down from heaven and God said, it's enough. It's enough. I'm going to bring you down. And God did. Now listen to me, dear people. Let's come back home where we're living today. Down here in Florida last week, they put to death the mad dog down there that killed all those young women. And they should have put him to death 10 years ago. We're living in a day whenever people today don't believe in capital punishment anymore. These liberals, these infidels say, I don't believe in capital punishment. Then they turn right around and encourage abortion. They don't believe in killing criminals that's killed maybe as many as 50 young women. They don't believe in killing him, putting him to death. Yet they do believe in mothers and doctors going out here and murdering unborn babes. There's thousands and thousands of babies that will be murdered next week, and they'll be screaming and crying as they're put to death. Beloved, listen to me. They believe in committing that kind of murder on the innocent that can't help itself, and yet that dirty mad dog criminal that's killed thousands of people like Carl Isaac and others, they don't believe in putting them to death. They'll do everything they can to keep them being put in an electric chair. Did you know there's five people that agreed for him to go ahead and be executed? That's the man in Florida. And then there's four that was against it. There's four people that did not want him to be electrocuted. And he'd been down there 11 years. Some said he may have killed as high as 100 young girls. Now think about that. And yet you find this group of liberals and infidels and anti-God and anti-Bible people today that's against capital punishment, against the death penalty. Not only that, in the paper last week, there came a picture of an individual, and there came articles of people that take a stand in the name of denomination religion, taking a stand for abortion. And of course, they want to be the people to know that their particular denomination that they belong to in the religious realm believe in murder, believe in abortion, and they, of course, would be against capital punishment. Even had enough brass on their face even to show their pictures in the paper, articles written about them, and yet they say we belong to a certain denomination. Now, you listen to me today. Very, very few people a day that belong to many of these large denominations know anything about God. Never been saved, never been born again. People like that have never been saved, never been washed in the blood of Jesus Christ, have never been born again. Our church today are filled with unregenerated people, filled with people that are not saved, people that don't know God, people that's going to hell when they die. Listen to me, if you are a born again believer, and you believe this Bible. Now you listen to me. If you are born again, believe, and you believe this Bible, you could not be for keeping criminals alive when God said they'll be put to death. You would not believe in keeping them alive if you believe this Bible, because you and God would not agree. Not only that, but you could not believe in having abortion after abortion after abortion and putting innocent people to death when you know it's a sin and you know it. God says it's killing people and you know it's dead wrong, and you agree to do that time and time again. You're disagreeing with God, you're disagreeing with this Bible, and you're dead wrong. I don't care who you are. If you're a liberal, you're an infidel, I don't care who you are. If you're a smart aleck, you think you know it all, you have your degrees, you may be a professor, a teacher, or whatnot, or a religious leader, you are dead wrong. This Bible is right, and you're wrong, and you're going to hell if you don't get saved. Now, you better believe that. Now, people today that don't believe this book, don't agree with this book, it tears me out of the frame when I see people on TV argue about the matter of drunkenness and argue about the matter of capital punishment, argue about the matter of abortion, and never one time do they go to this book to find out what God said in this Bible. This book is the final authority, not some denominational leader, not some ecclesiastical system. This book is the final authority. And God plainly said in this Bible, if a man commits murder, he's to pay the price, and his price is he's to be put to death. And you know as well as I that abortion is wrong. Beloved, you know it's wrong, and this Bible is against it, and you cannot agree with it to have it done time and time again, and unless you say, I don't agree with God, and I don't agree with this book. Now, we might as well face it today. God Almighty is not going to stand much longer for this drunken nation and this nation murdering the innocent and this nation keeping criminals out of the electorate here. God's not going to stand for it much longer. One of these days, God's going to come in and take over, and all this drunkenness and the dope and so forth has been peddled and sold in this country, and the murder and the stealing and the robbing and the killing, God is going to get enough of it. And you better believe that. The only safe place today is in Jesus Christ. You don't have many big shots today that's for the gospel. You don't have many radio stations, TV stations today that's for the gospel. They'd far rather have some beer program on some advertisement or something evil than to have the gospel presented. You know that as well as I. This world loves its own and getting worse all the time. and the world is headed toward hell and going down the broad road to destruction, and all this Bible hating, and people don't believe the word of God, don't believe in God, and don't believe in common decency, they're headed down the road to hell, and that's exactly where they're going. I don't care what denomination they belong to, whether it's Baptist, Methodist, Presbyterian, Lutherans, Episcopalians, Catholics, or whatnot. Beloved, this book is the final authority, and if we don't believe this Bible and do what this Bible says, we'd go to hell as certain as the world. Now, if you've never been saved, you're heading in that direction. I don't care how many churches you have joined, how many clubs you belong to, how many organizations you say that I belong to. You're headed toward hell if you don't get right with God according to this book. And there's only one way. And Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. And no man cometh to the Father except by me. Jesus either told a lie or he told the truth. And if Jesus Christ told the truth, no man will go to heaven when he dies without Jesus Christ in his heart. And you'll not have Jesus Christ in your heart unless you repent of your sins and receive Jesus as your Savior. And if you hadn't done that, you're on your own to hell. I don't care how much religion you got, how many times you've been baptized, Christian, or whatnot. If you don't have Jesus Christ in your heart, in the person of the Holy Spirit, you've never repented, you've never been saved, you're headed down the broad road and you're going to hell like millions of others without God. Now you better check up and find out where you live or where you stand. Because God is not going to always put up with what's going on in America today. Homosexuality, all kind of perversions, this and that, things that God Almighty destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah for. And God said destroy upon the earth. These homosexuals, God had them destroyed in his day. And God's not always going to put up what's going on in America. Now you better mark that down. And you don't have many preachers today that's got guts enough to tell the people about it. You don't have many that's got guts enough to stand up and warn the people and tell the truth, because they're afraid of the orders and afraid of this world out here. But as long as God Almighty gives me strength and breath to do it, I'm going to stand up and preach it, whether people like it or not. I'm going to preach the word of God, because I got to face God when I die, and you have too. And I want to tell the truth about the matter before I leave this world. Let's stand our feet. Father in heaven, I pray today you'll take the message and use it. Speak to our hearts. Speak to many people out in the radio listening audience. I pray, may your name be honored. May Jesus be glorified. We realize old Belshazzar all shook up and died and went to hell. Lord, there's a lot of people shook up today on the road to hell or die like Belshazzar and end up in hellfire. God, speak to somebody that might get saved. I pray in the name of Jesus and for his sake.